A huge week in politics, and our two regulars have some, well, very different job titles this morning. The tables certainly have well and truly turned. Joining us now is Deputy Prime Minister Richard Marles in Geelong. And there he is, the Stephen Bradbury of the coalition leadership, Peter Dutton. Good morning, gentlemen. How are we? How does that sit with you, Pete?
Morning, Carl.
Morning, Carlos.
Morning, Peter.
DPM, how are you?
I'm good.
Oh. I got you. Sorry. Anyway,
good. How are you though?
It's so nice. It's so nice. It's unbelievable. You guys talking to each other in such a nice fashion. Well, the country, Peter, the country has changed its curtains, but the Liberal Party hasn't really, has it? Just, you know, one middle-aged white guy subbing in for another.
Geez, Carl, you're right off the bat there. Look, I think if you have a look at what happened last weekend. There were people right across the country in their millions who supported the Liberal Party, and the time now for us, after any election loss, and it was the same with Labor in 2013 as well, the party needs to come together, and that's exactly what we're doing. We're in the process of reforming, and we'll be a formidable force by the time of the next election in 2025. But there's a lot of work to be done between now and then, and I think this is going to be a bad government. I think things are going to be worse and tough under Labor. And you're already seeing Jim Chalmers out there trying to, you know, soften people up for higher taxes, and you can expect higher electricity prices under Labor as well.
How will you be different to Scott Morrison exactly?
Well, we're two different people, and for me, I have a lot of respect for Scott and all of my former leaders, but I grew up under John Howard. I was Assistant Treasurer to Peter Costello. I think, an incredible work ethic, and I have a desire to do what is right by our country. I've had tough jobs in immigration, border protection, and in defence, and you're always talking about tough topics. I hope that people can see, you know, the complete picture of who I am, and I intend to traverse the country over the next 3 years, listen importantly to what people want. But for me, I come from the suburbs. I've never forgotten my roots, and I have those values near and dear. I want to support families who are struggling at the moment, and families who will struggle to pay higher electricity prices under an Albanese government.
Okay, just on that, Richard, power prices, how long will it take for you to get prices down with your energy policy?
Well, firstly, Carl, can I just say, in all seriousness with Peter, it is a very big thing to lead one of the parties of government. And it's you know, a significant moment in Peter's life to be leading the Liberal Party. So I genuinely want to say congratulations and wish him well. I mean, not that well, but wish him, in this initial moment, wish him well. Look, to answer your question about power prices, let's be clear. The government covered up this announcement until after the election, the former government, I should say. So that right there is a disgrace. And the fact that the default price is moving now by such a degree, which will see people paying hundreds more in energy costs, says everything about the consequence of nine years of inaction on energy policy.
I think Chris Yuleman had that story a number of months ago. I think everyone knew, though, that the prices were going up. And renewables don't guarantee cheaper prices, do they?
Well, getting more renewables on board does do that. I mean, the great difference now compared to a decade ago is that renewable energy is cheap energy. But you've got to make sure that you've got an energy grid which can take it. And that's what our policy has been, that we took to the election, is all about. Upgrading the power grid, the energy grid, so that it can take on more renewables and get renewables going. But what we see here is the direct consequence of 9 years of the coalition government doing nothing in respect of renewable energy.
Okay.
And being completely paralysed when it comes to energy policy.
Okay.
And this is the consequence.
Pete, the Australian Chamber of Commerce wants you to provide bipartisan support for Labor's energy policy. Will you do that?
Well, Carl, we've got a policy. We'll have a look at what Labor's got on the table. But for the Liberal Party, we want to make sure that, that people can afford to turn the lights on, and that when you turn the lights on, there is actually power there. And I worry under this government that we're not going to have the reliability in our energy system. I want to see Australian jobs grow here. I want to see manufacturing flourish, but we can only do that if one of the biggest input costs is affordable. And if prices skyrocket under Labor, which we project they will, then it will mean jobs go offshore. It will mean families can't afford to pay their power bills. It'll mean small businesses can't afford to operate and to expand. And, you know, the Deputy Prime Minister is in a position now where he's not in opposition. He can't complain. He's told the Australian people he's got answers to all of these problems. And instead of complaining about us, we want to hear what the government's got to say. And so far, it's nothing but excuses.
Okay, we're almost out of time. Richard, the WA Premier, he certainly dances to his own tune, doesn't he? You said he was right last week when he said that Pete isn't really smart. Do you stand by those comments this morning, or are we a bit more lovey-dovey?
Look, Mark McGowan speaks sense. That's what I would say.
New era. And Pete, were you in this new era, were you hurt by Tanya Plibersek's comments at all?
No, Carl, I've read Twitter before. There's plenty out there. I've got a pretty robust character, and she made a mistake. She apologised for it, and I appreciate her apology. I just think we need to, frankly, behave like adults and get on with the issues that are important to our country. And Tanya's now become a minister in a government. She's got a big job, and you know, casting aspersions about people's physical appearance is something that I'd be surprised if she's got time for. She's got a big job, and things are going to be tougher under Labor, no question.
Can you reveal any information about that condition that you mentioned yesterday, if it's not too personal?
Well, it must be a slow news day, Carl. No, I said yesterday, I've got dodgy genes, so I'm not sort of, you know, bald by choice. But a couple of years ago, I got diagnosed just through a regular skin checkup, which I'd recommend everybody does. If you haven't had one in the last 12 months, book in with a skin clinic or a dermatologist today, because we know that skin cancers are a big issue in our country. But he just diagnosed like a sort of a form of alopecia where the skin follicles die off effectively. So not only bad genes, but that, which is, you know, I mean, it's not painful or anything else. Yeah. Just there in the background. But once your hair follicles die off, they don't grow back. So, I mean, Richard's got it all going for him. He's smart. He's got hair.
He's got great hair.
He's sarcastic. He's basically not got a clue, but we love him anyway. So there you go.
Very good, guys. Thank you so much. And congratulations to you both on winning your seats back. Appreciate your time today. Ali.
All right. Well, the soaring price of power has got households right across the country feeling on edge. And Queensland pensioners Des and Lynn Weeks have previously written in to us and shared their concerns. They're now even more concerned about making ends meet, and they join us again now. Nice to see you both this morning. Hey, look, Des, $165 is going to be added to the average electricity bill in Queensland. How are you guys going to go with that?
Not very well, Ali. Actually, ours, we've calculated that our increase will be more than that, because the company that we were with, LPE, they've written to us and said they're no longer able to provide household power, and so we've had to look around somewhere else, and we estimate that it'll probably be in the vicinity of $3 to $3.50 extra a year. So, yes, it's going to impact us a fair bit.
Yeah. So, Lynn, on top of everything else, then.
Because
on top of everything else, you've got petrol and grocery prices. Will you be able to make ends meet, or are you going to have to give some things up?
Well, last time we spoke to you, we said we were giving things up. This year, we nearly gave up private health insurance, but luckily we didn't. We now need it. And, we're dipping in to our savings, our super, and I jokingly said to our friends, well, when I run out of money, I'll have to take a pill, because we can't live on the pension, but we are dipping in, and we'll have to cut back. We lead a very active, healthy lifestyle, but we don't know how long that'll go.
And with the price of petrol increasing, we're paying at the moment about $2.12 or more a litre up here, and when the excise duty goes out in September, who knows what the price of petrol is going to be then? So I drive around in a little old bomb of a Toyota, and just to go to bowls, etc. We look as though we will be selling that, and just rely on our 2007 Honda. So that's the situation we're in, and with due respect to the two previous people, the price of electricity in Queensland has been on the news for quite a while, and I think whoever's the government now have got a hell of a job to do something about it. So whatever
Absolutely.
They do is.
Yeah, look, I mean, I think you've shared there. So. I think you've shared there the sentiments of many, many people. It's tough and it's about to get a whole lot tougher. Yeah. I hope our politicians are listening. We appreciate you coming on this morning. Thanks, guys. Carl.
Can I just say one thing about this couple here? That
Thanks
is a
lot.
Great looking couple. That is. They are proper Australians right there.
Oh, Carl. Thank you.
He's flirting with you, Lynn.
I'd love to say.
Flirting.
Oh!
I'd love to say the same about you two. So, Ali, I would, but I don't know about you, Carl.
Fair enough. I think the
and
same.
And you're a Queenslander. Queensland supporter.
I shouldn't have opened up that chat.
Yeah.
Not good.
I was forbidden to wear my Queensland scarf this morning.
You can wear a Queensland scarf anytime you want.